my inconsistent pleasure to introduce Mosheh Wolf, Dr. Mosheh Wolf from now Department of Urban Planning and Policy Administration in the College of Urban Planning, who is a field ecologist.
And an urban ecologist.
And an urban ecologist. Field urban ecologist. How about that? And
I'm going to help you get conversant, at least in ecology, so that when you meet an ecologist from Princeton, it won't sound like they're speaking gibberish, or any more than normal ecologists sound to each other. Mm-hmm. It's a very complex and wide field, and so. But I like introducing what's ecology, and if 40, it's probably changed that. The number of hits that when you put ecology in, and the stuff which pops up there, when we're talking about a misused word, ecology fits that. Anybody wants to try anything which is social justice is green, toss in ecology. Ecology building society, mortgages and investment, what that has to do with ecology, I don't know, but ecology. Ecology center promotes environmentally and socially responsible practices through programs, educate, demonstrate. That's environmentalism, that's not ecology. The institute, if it's liberal, if it's social justice, we'll toss in ecology. But it really is not ecology. Now, these are just some really crazy ones. Ecology, the fashion. Mission, vibrant neighborhoods are building blocks of healthy cities. Still my favorite is the ecology, the fashion. Fashion boutique, dress in ecology. We go to our trusty, trusty dictionary, and that's what ecology, basically ecos, logica, it's the house, the dwelling place, and the science of study, the dwelling place. In short, it is a science which deals with the interrelations between any living organism and this one. If it's not dealing with that, it's not ecology. If it's dealing with that, then you can call it ecology. Yes, and it was, so you can see it's been around for quite a bit. Probably the first modern ecologist who did ecology as we do now was Humboldt, mid-19th century. The term was coined by Ernst Haeckel, philosopher, scientist, and has been used ever since. Modern ecology was developed at the beginning of the 20th century, and they had ecology textbooks for school, for classes by the 1920s and a bit of it. So it's pretty nice and old. I won't go any more into the history because that's for fun. And so the first term that you really have to understand when you talk about ecology is scales. Yeah, I make fun of that. Because ecology fits in, when you talk about science deals with things at different scales. Different natural sciences deal with the natural world at different scales. So physics deals with the most fundamental. Subatomic molecule. Chemistry, you go up one level and talk about molecules to multiple molecules, and biology, from organic molecules to organic, and ecology starts covering individual organisms. It will deal with anything that deals with individual organism to the entire world, to the entire body. Within ecology, you can also divide the scales, and that's a really good way to divide the types of ecology. So individual organisms, there's a lot of study of ecology at the level of individual organisms, one individual, one species. Of course, you're doing sample size and multiple, but you're really how an organism interacts. We'll talk about that. Populations, multiple organisms of the same species. Communities, a whole group of organisms of different species, and then it's really rather than increase in scale, it's almost a step sideways to ecosystem, because that's the community, and you add the entire non-organic environment which surrounds it. So at the scale of the organism, I mean, it's still the same multiple species, multiple individuals, but you've added something on, and then that's about then, when you step out of ecosystems, you really are looking at biomes, which then shifts to biogeography, which is a sister study, a sister discipline to ecology. And as it says, biogeography, the geography of life. Just really quick, there are different, when you're studying these things, the scale also determines the scale at which you look at them, how long these things happen, which also will determine your research. What scale should I look at this research? So if you're looking at individuals, really, it's anywhere between hours. Actually, if you're looking at microbial ecology, you quite often will have even minutes. But usually, when we're talking about processes which last for hours to years, there are some individuals, I mean, this is general because there are exceptions. Some individuals will live more than just years, decades and centuries. But this is only ecology. I'd like to admit, is rough. It's not physics, it's not accurate. It has rough edges, it has hazy borders. When you talk about populations, and this happened usually over years, we're talking about things dealing with breeding. Generations, and you're talking usually about years. Again, you're talking about microbial ecology, you can have generations every half an hour. By and large, though, we're talking years to decades. Communities, then the interactions, the processes which you're looking at, go over from years to centuries. Because you see changes in composition. A species comes in, a species goes out. These are things which happen over years and centuries. And ecosystems can last millennia. We're talking large, really large-scale, long-term processes. Large-scale, we're talking about flux of energy, we're talking about cycles. For example, the water cycle for the ocean is about 100 years for it to, when it comes up from one part to get back to where that molecule is, some things take longer. Of course, there are exceptions. I'm mentioning aspen clones. You walk through a forest, you think that you're talking about a population. It's actually all connected underneath a single individual. There are exceptions, but this is. It also means that when you're doing a research project in ecology, in individuals, you can quite often follow them through a process. If you're looking at the change of the response to changes in temperature, you can follow a single individual from over a change of temperature. You're talking about populations, sometimes you can come back, same population next year and see changes. But when you're talking about just a population of chimpanzees or long-lived animals, it becomes difficult to follow them across the region. By the time we get to communities, most of our research is done through snapshots. We are taking the situation now, and we are taking what the situation is now, extrapolating, maybe find evidence, but these are working. The studies that you're doing on communities is quite often snapshots. Ecosystems, sometimes you can go across this, but sometimes it can go from years, so if you want to look at the flux of the energy production of a certain ecosystem over a year, you can do that. But if you want to look at some of the much larger cycles, you either extrapolate or take a snapshot and see what you can do with it. And this is when you're starting to work with ecologists, understand that the different scales that you're working do determine what data you're working with. Now the biomes and bioregions for biogeography, these can go 100,000 years, a million years. This is, they look at the changes in these different bioregions, the Arctic, or that, over the Ice Age, over the Paleolithic, over eons, epochs. So, but ecologists, sort of, when they move to that, they're called biogeographers. And you probably won't be working with them on this course. However, again, the border becomes fuzzy. So when you're talking about physiological ecology, sorry, that's almost entirely deals with individuals. Okay? What's happening to individuals? But if you're talking about behavioral ecology, it's one of the favorite. Everybody wants to look at behavioral ecology. That you can talk about behavior of an individual, but you can also talk about behavior at the level of a population. A herd movement. Interactions that happen. When you're talking about pecking order, you can't do pecking order. It's not an individual. It has to be a population. You're talking about, when they're talking about the response of, what was it, great tits to the amount of food there is, you're talking about the level of the individual. So there are some subfields within ecology that cover multiple scales. The rule of scale, the rules which determine what you're looking at, still hold there. But know that when you're talking about subfields within ecology, they can quite often span multiple scales. Confused? I have to try harder. What do we mean ecology? What does ecology of individuals cover? What are the sort of things that you study in ecology of an individual? And this is, when you're talking especially in extreme situations, this is a wonderful thing. Okay, so if you are an organism, you typically only experience your environment at a very, very, very local scale. You don't really feel what's happening on the outside of the head. And at the level, and this is an interesting thing, because at the level of individual, you include the abiotic. The abiotic becomes as important as the biotic when you're looking at what's happening at the level of an individual, when you're looking at physiological ecology. Population can quite often ignore the abiotic. At the individual, physiological ecology, which is like a classic individual ecology, subfield works and the abiotic and biotic. So, what does physiological ecology do? What is it all about? By definition, life, if you're living, you have a higher level of organization than your environment, right? And basic laws of entropy mean that you have to invent, you can't just let it. If you let it be, you'll fall to pieces eventually. You constantly have to strive, so to speak, to retain this integrity. So you have that. You also, if living things reproduce. So, these are all living things. They must replace the mass which is lost in the environment, because as much as you strive, you're going to be losing stuff to the environment. You're going to be losing mass and energy. And you're constantly doing that. Forget about shedding skin. You're talking atoms are just shearing off. You have to replace what's being lost in the environment. You also have to maintain chemical functions. Right? You have to keep that blood moving. You have to keep the oxygen going. You have to keep food digesting. You have to keep the electrochemical processes of your brain going. And ultimately, you need to reproduce, means that you need to create a new you. So you need energy for this. You need energy. You need, because every one of those processes, again, entropy, if you want to retain your integrity, if you want to, you need energy. You also need materials. Again, you need organic materials to begin with, because that's the building, that's what biology is. And you need non-organic materials. And this can be anything from oxygen to salt to sodium in its inorganic form. It's generally called nutrients. It differs, actually, this is a major difference, which I won't really go into very much, between plants or autotrophs and heterotrophs, is that plants, for example, almost only require non-organic materials. They are carbon, their organic materials are produced within the plants. Animals cannot do that, and they need to obtain organic materials. So the relative importance of these two differs depending on what you're working with. And this leads me to an aside. This is another important term, trade-offs. So in this case, we're talking about at the level of the individual physiology, the trade-off is any of those things can come at, will come at the expense of the other. Reproduction will always come at the expense of maintain of investing in yourself. It can be, and that's fundamental. When you're investing, when you're reproducing, you are using energy and materials which you could be using to make yourself bigger, to keep yourself alive longer, to create a new organism. In any case, all actions come at the expense of others because there's only so much time in a day, there's only so much time in a lifetime, and if you're doing one thing, you can't be doing the other thing. Sometimes, when you're doing one process, you can't do, or it causes you to lose work. So, if you want to build more mass, that costs energy, right? So you can either collect energy, you can either have mass. These are the basic thing is life, ecology will keep on coming back to trade-offs. You have to figure out what more on one, more on the other. This is that physiological, we will look, we will see it again in other processes. Okay? If you're looking at, when we're talking about physiological ecology, talk about the physiology. It's basically not just the physiology is not, it's physiology, it's not ecology. It becomes physiological ecology when we look at how those physiological processes relate to its environment. If we're just looking at how an animal breathes, how it converts how it passes oxygen in its blood to its other cells, that's physiology. We're looking at how that physiology is related to its environment. I'll give an example. Obtaining energy in plants. Okay, this, if you just look at the physiological, we're talking about this is photosynthesis. That's how they obtain energy. They take energy from the sun and they use it to break apart a water molecule and transfer that energy to create sugar and everything. And they use that sugar either as a building block for other organic materials or as an energy store. That is just the process, okay? If we look at just that photosynthesis, that's a physiological process. When does it become ecology? One of the characteristics of photosynthesis is that it needs to be done inside water, it needs to be exposed to the sun. What that means is that your now water is evaporating. And it's also you're paying energy gain, you're heating up, water is being lost. Overall, it's not a problem if you're living in a pond. But when water is scarce, then you have to stop thinking. And this, you're in an environment which is dry, you're in an environment where this loss of water starts hurting, and this steps into ecology, and this steps into trade-off. You have to think retaining water versus capturing energy. And that states what we're looking at. So, in the physiological, if you're looking at physiological ecology, you're going to look at things like adaptation. Adaptations, how plants deal with this environmental constraint. That's another term which I should have introduced, constraints. You can only do so much, constraint. I'll come up and if I toss out a term that I haven't thought or I've forgotten to define, please, if you don't understand the term in the way that I'm using it, I know that the terms that ecologists use in a way which doesn't match their use in just say math or computer science, for example, constraint. So sometimes it's morphological. let's pull those stomata, those are the openings that allow carbon dioxide to come in, oxygen to leave, allow photosynthesis to happen. Let's pull them down low, so we're in a very tight area, so water vapor reaches its basically at the highest level it can be. You stop or you reduce the loss due to evaporation. You can put hairs to keep the movement of air to minimum. The movement of air increases evapotranspiration, increases evaporation of water. You reduce that so you're not losing as much water. Okay? That is morphological. And sometimes these physiological are chemical. And this is true for all adaptations to any environment. With adaptations to cold, we have chemical, we have morphological. Morphological, fat, chemical, antifreeze inside the blood. So there's two types of, they just change the photosynthesis. C4 is a chemical way which basically allows it to grab CO2 at lower concentrations. So it only opens a lot, grabs a whole bunch of air and closes it. And it can keep on pulling CO2 from that air long after when it's way below the normal of the surroundings. So that way you can open up, grab some air, close it. Another is you can take is CAM photosynthesis, which you grab all the carbon dioxide at night and hold it. You're holding carbon dioxide until light comes out and then you photosynthesize. Whereas you use it photosynthesis. So you separate physically, or you separate, but these are chemical morphological adaptations. This is the sort of thing that when you're looking at the ecology of an individual, you look at physiological ecology, works with things like that. It can work with, I talked about adaptations, these wonderful adaptations to cold, blubber, hair, countercurrents in the extremities. This is stuff which is, this can be anywhere from an entire lecture to an entire course. But this, when they're taught, this is a one level at the individual, at the level of individual physiology, how that relates, how it becomes ecology. And this is just so you can actually look what it looks like, the hairs and the stomata, and this is how, if any rewrite of the calendar, this is just basically how it stores. It's storing the carbon dioxide in the water and using it during the day, and this is how it does in C4. But this is just a visual. I think that things are jumping. Some of these slides won't look as nice because they're matching. Any questions? Yeah.
So are you saying that you can look at physiological adaptations at the level of individual? That's an ecological question.
That's an
ecological question.
How
does the individual adapt to their environment?
Adapt, how does it? What is the result?
Oh, yeah, the result.
If you look at the process of adaptation, then you're looking at evolution. Again, evolution and ecology are so very intertwined. Ecology, it doesn't make any sense without looking at the evolutionary history. Evolution is meaningless. It doesn't work unless you assume ecology. Now, we step to next thing. At the intersection of individuals and populations are termed, and this again, also strongly connected. Some parts of ecology are more tightly intertwined with evolution than others. This is one of them. Life history and life cycles. These are individual characteristics, but they really work at the level of the population. So you have these two, life cycles and life histories. They sound similar, they're very different. Life cycle is basically the life cycle. It's the sequence of stages from birth or hatch, or actually from conception, from fertilization to death. All multicellular organisms go through stages. They don't come into this world fully formed. Bacteria do, split. Basically, the life cycle of a bacteria is I split from the mother cell and I go on until I split into two cells. More or less, that's how it works. When you're talking about multicellular organisms, it becomes a bit more complex. These things, life cycle is sort of hardwired. It is for a species. All members of that species will have more or less this type of life cycle. Life history is how long it lives, how many times it reproduces, what are the size of the litter. This can change between populations. An individual from one part of the world will not always behave the same way as an individual for another. It might have more. For example, I studied white-footed mice, common woodland mouse here. If you look at it, summer reproduction in southern Illinois, it breeds in the spring and it breeds in early fall. If you go up in Canada, it reproduces only once in the summer. These are two different life histories for the same species. So, life cycles, example of typical life cycles, you have the two insects. If we're talking about animals, then we have to talk about insects because insects basically represent 3/4 of all living species. Insects are just everywhere. They might be small, but they're everywhere and they're most diverse group cats on the face of the earth. And within that, beetles are the most diverse group order. So they have two major life cycles. They have a complete and incomplete. The classical complete, basically the egg, a larva, then reproductive. So I'm not considering the pupa because pupa is not really a stage, it's a transition between the two. A reproductive stage and then a very short life after, which is in insects is totally meaningless. Once it's reproduced, it can die. But they don't always die, they buzz around. Literally. Other insects and most other arthropods have egg, non-reproductive juvenile, reproductive adult, short, so very short or non-existent. So you have fertilized egg, whatever invests decreases however long it's as an egg. You have a mantis, it's a nymph, non-reproductive juvenile. You have very similar in crabs, you'll have similar things in spiders, you'll have similar things in ticks, you'll have similar things in squid. You have these species. In humans, is a very strange, and this is actually very rare. So I was going to birds. This is a much more common in larger vertebrates. On invertebrates, is you have the egg stage, you have the juvenile, which is still being taken care of by its parents. And then you have a juvenile, which is on its own, reproductive, short or non-existent, non-reproductive. For example, birds never really reach senescence. They'll breed until they die. A short sort of. These are examples. There are some even stranger. There are species that, especially parasites, have some of the most fascinating. It has one type of larva, and then it parasitizes another organism, gets secreted, and then a different stage parasitizes another reproductive. It's just very, very complex. These are classes. So if we're talking about many of the monkey, many of the primates, and you'll be out in Africa and primates pop up, you have an infant and a very long stage in which you are a non-reproductive juvenile under being taken care of, which you cannot survive on your own. that you need a parent. And you can see that among many mammals. Then you have a juvenile, which is non-reproductive, a reproductive. And then humans have this long post-reproductive living. And it's not only, there are other primates in which, especially females, will live long after they are no longer reproductive. There's many, many theories, but again, and then you have plants, in which you have, you go from the seed, from the same as the egg, and you have multiple stages before you're reproductive. The seedling, just that little piece coming out, then you have a sapling, then a reproductive, and then you live for a very long time, and your reproduction tends to slow down. You don't have post-reproductive, you really don't survive beyond that, but you quite often have lower. A schematic life cycle, you have the juvenile dominated by growth, you have the reproductive, and the reproduction changes over your life. And it's very typical for organisms, which we'll talk about that in a minute, who reproduce multiple times, to have different levels of reproductive over their lives, and then the end and whatever post-reproductive phase. It's just very schematic. This is how it looks. Reproductive output over time. I think life cycles are. Life histories, you can look at them in different ways. Again, this is something which goes, because when you're looking at this ecologically, when you of life history, how long it lives, or how many times it breeds. Okay? When you talk about how long it lives, they're really divided among most multicellular organisms to annuals, perennials. Live one set of seasons. Actually, they quite often use annuals for organisms that don't live an entire year. If you're living a single season, you're still considered annual. So plants, a lot of these plants, they sprout in the spring. They're dead by the end of summer. They really did, well, they might have been a seed, but sometimes they don't even live that. They live a single season. Mostly it's a year because you were produced before, but quite often you live a single season. Perennials, you're living multiple seasons. Semilparous are called monocarpic. You reproduce once in your life. And that's very common. Iteroparous or polycarpic in plants, within your lifetime, you would produce multiple times. And you would think that annuals are the ones that reproduce once, perennials are the ones that reproduce multiple times. It ain't necessarily so. And I'll explain and I'll show examples. So, these are animals which breed, how did I do that? Which breed once in their lifetime, the cell pairs, and it can be, okay. Plants quite often fill that thing that they did 1 year, reproduce once. Weeds, very common. They you put in a seed, it grows up, puts up flowers, puts up multiple seeds, flood, and then it dies. But there are other plants that live multiple years, but only reproduce once. One of the most common is bamboo. Bamboo can live 130 years, reproduces once, dies. Among animals, there are annuals and semilparous, but such as most insects, they live 1 year, they reproduce at the end of that, die. Not all insects, but things like an octopus. Octopuses live multiple years. They only reproduce once. An octopus can live 5 years. These giant octopuses live 5 years, reproduce, and die. Perennial, shrubs, trees, people, birds, anything which lives multiple years. Usually they reproduce less, each reproduction is less, not always so, but it's multiple episodes of reproduction and multiple years limit. polycarpic, materials, an oak tree, you can define, again, within that, you can have multiple, so within multiple episodes, within those multiple episodes, you can have multiple episodes of many offspring, or multiple episodes of few offspring. Larger offspring, few, large, many, small. Again, we talk about an oak, we talk about a maple, multiple times, and it blankets the forest with seeds. People, geckos, for example, 2 eggs, that's it. There are other lizards, 13 eggs. It's just, these are just definitions, these are different characteristics. And these can also, all of these can change. There are some plants that are some, that in some areas are perennial, other areas are annual. The number of individuals which, the number of individual young, which, sorry, number of young that individual has can change between areas. The number of times you reproduce during your lifetime, during a year, can change between areas. These, and this is where we start looking at the ecology. Because if we're just looking at how these differ, that's evolution, that's, but what we're looking at ecology is how the local environment. So if we go back to my mice, why we, there's the pattern that you have multiple, you have, they would breed twice, and I've seen in central Illinois, I've noticed them even reproducing 3 times. If you're up in Canada, they once. Because that's where they need to be college. Because in central, southern Illinois, that summer is really, really hot. The possible time they can breed is pretty long because it's warm enough to breed. It doesn't take a lot of energy to keep the young warm by March. But July, August, it's too hot. Come September, they still have enough time. They still have the 3 weeks of pregnancy and 3 weeks of until it grows up to put in another reproductive. You are in Canada, it's not warm enough to reproduce until May. It starts getting too cold by the end of September. But in August, it's not that cold, not that hot. Then you can actually reproduce, so you don't have to slow down, you don't have to relax, you don't have to worry about overheating. Same species, they're different ecology, they're different life histories because they have different environments. This is what I'm talking about, talking ecology. And yes?
How about those bugs, animals in general, not so particular, I guess, that come in cycles, but the cycle length is not, I mean, the period is about 2 or 3 years. I'm thinking about June bugs, they come every 2 or 3 years. I think they're larvae in the first year and then they become adults, so they have 2 years life cycle. Are those annual, perennial?
Those are perennial. Semelparis. And the classical cases, of course, of our friend, the cicada.
Yeah.
We're talking about the outbreaks of cicadas. There's mostly 17 years in some areas where they're 13 years. They are perennial. They've been living. We tend to think of the adult, the reproductive adult in insects as important. We look at the butterfly, but usually they only live as adults, the reproductive adults, for a small fraction of their life. So these live as 17 years as nymphs underground, and they appear massive. It's an adaptation. There we go to evolutionary ecology, because it's their environment, their interaction with predators, that goes to ecology, but it also, their evolutionary history determines this. It's a way to escape predation. First of all, you reproduce massive reproduction, the chance of an individual surviving become higher. But, and this is a fascinating little thing, I'll do this because I do go on tangents. When we talk about the cicada, 17 years, why is it 17 years? Mathematician, what's the characteristic of 17? So first thing?
It's prime.
Prime. Because this is prey. So animals can track. So yes, if you have massive outbreak of sickness, then you just have a massive outbreak of the predator. The predator keeps the reproduction, so for the June bugs, every 2 years, you have its predator come out in massive numbers every 2 years. It you can basically track. If you are doing that once every 17 years, two-year animal, predators can't track you, three-year, four-year, you, in order to track them, you have to be have a 17-year cycle yourself, and that is extremely rare in both vertebrates. Yeah. And in the shortened one, at 13 years, it seems like there was a fungus that in some areas was able to create a 17-year tracking cycle. It was shortened to 13 to miss. Bamboo does the same thing by just being that long. It doesn't have to be prime if it happens for every 130 years. It helped the pandas the fact that because when this species flowers, then all the members of that species will flower at once and then they all die. Until these new seeds grow, there will be no bamboo of this species. And so the pandas made a bet. It's a long term, I live off of these. A few years ago, once in a few thousand years it happens, two-thirds or half the species of bamboo which lived on flowered. It coincided at once. It was a massive die-out of pandas. One of the reasons they don't know if they're of salvation, because suddenly they don't have enough food. This it's a once in a thousand. Made a bet, and sometimes it doesn't pay off. This relates to evolutionary ecology, adaptations, how you deal long-term versus what the actual adaptation is. And this is another classic case of trade-off. You have X amount of energy to put into reproduction. The question is, do we produce small number of low quality or large number of high quality? And different things. And we indeed see, that there's a relationship between the number and energy. And the local environmental conditions can determine that. If it's pretty harsh and small individuals can't survive, you want to have a few high quality. Better conditions, or sometimes better conditions mean smaller ones, but it's usually larger is better for harsh conditions. But more means that you'll have more living offspring if they can survive. So these, again, this works out the concept of trade-off. And this trade-off feeds in ecology all the time. You have X amount of energy, X amount of time, X amount of, you want to put in one or the other, or doing one makes the other difficult. What do you do? When do we invest in one versus the other? Actually, till what time? Now we've stepped up to populations. We've left individuals behind. A population, you start coming to something which individuals, by and large, we know where an individual begins, where it ends. Not always, but usually. If you're looking at a bee, you know where is bee and where is not bee. When we're talking about populations, it becomes a bit more difficult. It's still possible, but sometimes you can't look at the real population, you take an arbitrary, these individuals. Populations, sometimes actually mostly when we're talking about populations with implying breeding, if they breed within the population at a higher rate than individuals outside of the population, that's a decent definition of a population, but sometimes you don't have that. Again, microbial ecology, they're not really breeding with one another, what's a population? Sometimes you have defined, sometimes you don't. Colonies, where you can usually see this colonism, but sometimes individuals, especially animals, move over a large area into intermix, leave. It's a term that everybody knows what it means, but nobody can really define it. But it's a very useful term, and I'll show you why. Because populations start with mathematics. Until now, it's observations. It is multiple observation. You're still using statistics, but you're really looking at the actual observation. Movement of oxygen. But here, it really, math becomes a central part of seeing what happened in the population, which is why you have computational population biology. You don't really have a lot of computational behavior ecology at the level of the individual. The first definition is distribution. The first term is a distribution, how a population. Now, when we talk about animals, it really doesn't make, I mean, the distribution becomes a bit more complex, but if we're talking about plants, the distribution becomes a very important factor in looking at it, because that's why are they distributed that way, becomes an ecological question. And the standard ways, of course, are random, uniform, and clumped. Random, basically, if you look at the distribution of distances, they fall in a more or less Gaussian distribution. Uniform, they tend to be very similar. Clumped, you have this very uneven distribution. A lot of short distances, very few, and a lot of long distances. That's the difference between clumped. An interesting thing, just an aside, is that people are really bad at identifying comparing random and uniform. This looks uniform. In fact, most people look at uniform and think that it's random. I wish I had that picture, but I took it off because, at least relative to people, that's a random distribution. But people look at them in patterns, because we start creating patterns, and when we create patterns, when the patterns stand out, then we no longer think of that as, we no longer think of that as random. If we have a relatively uniform distribution, they're not in nice lines, and we can no longer form patterns, then we think that's random. But actually, it's uniform, relative, okay? Just an aside. It's the ecology which usually determines this, ecology and the behavior. Random, when there's no advantage in being anywhere specific, and where an organism lands is determined by random factors. Dandelions across a field, they're spread out wherever they land. Uniform, competition keeps you away from each other at certain distances. You'll have uniform, and clumped if resources are clumped. Then organisms tend to be clumped around the resources. Just on the side. The second important thing about populations is dynamics. When we're looking at a population, it's meaningless unless we're looking at the reproduction, at the dynamics, how the numbers of this population change over time. Otherwise, an individual stays one individual. I mean, its physiology can change, but it's one individual. Populations change. This is one of the processes. And this goes to math. I mean, the level of math that I can teach with it, I think, is not going to be as high as your guys. You guys have better background in math than I do, and are much better at it. But this is basically. So the four processes, I mean, it's almost trivial. But birth, immigration, death, emigration. The population increases because of birth and because of immigration. It decreases because of death and emigration by model. Nothing special. I mean, it's one of those questions, so why only those? Because if we look at the population and we've defined all increases and decreases by these four processes, it's really. And of course, you start looking at the very simple map. Population change. Most of math is actually starts ignoring immigration and emigration, because they tend not to be the strongest ones. Quite often you're looking at birth and death. And this is why you've seen E and I have seemed to have dropped. It simplifies and it's easier to follow. And it quite often deals with the more basic ecological processes. But emigration and immigration are not trivial, but the earliest models, the simplest models, ignore them. Because numerically, they can be minor. So this is, I don't think that I have to explain much of that. This is the basic model. N at time t plus an increment of time, productive. Basic looks at the at over an increment of time is basically the birth within that period to the death. The time defined birth rate, death rate. Or birth as a function of time, death as a function of time. If I'm making mistakes in the math, feel free to correct me. Ah, shoot. That should have been earlier. No, it isn't. Let's step back. I said that life history affects an individual, but it reflects onto the population, and this is how. When you look at the dynamics of a population, the reproductive rate, the reproductive period of this species is what determines birth and death. And so when you take, just say, this is a life history of a great tit, 50 eggs, survival, nestlings, fledglings, adults. You feed this in, if you want to figure out what the population dynamics are, what the birth and death rate are, how that affects. Because it looks like too simple, birth rate, death rate, not so simple because it comes here. So, because it's not simple, let's count how many are born. No, how many are born, we'll know for next year, but how many survive? If we want to look at reproduction over not one increment of time, but over long term, then we have to start looking at a much more complex. And one of the basic tools, one of the basic tools for looking at population dynamics based on life history is the life table. Life table is something that was invented by, does anyone know who developed this tool? It wasn't ecologists, that's my first thing.
The same guy who made the dynamic model?
What?
Is it the same guy who came up with the dynamic population model?
No, but I'll
so
give
you.
No. Look at that tone. That's the hint.
Insurance?
What?
Insurance?
Yes.
Company?
Insurance companies, actuaries. They wanted to calculate life expectancy. You need to know all of these. That's how they can, when they start the life expectancy, the average life expectancy, this is how. And you don't have to remember. If you ever have to look at reproductive rate of a population, you can go and pick this out of any textbook. But these are the basic terms, and they look very familiar. The age interval, basically, if we're talking about most species, reproduce at certain times. It's not continuous reproduction. So the age interval at which you're looking quite often matches, but doesn't have to. And in humans, every year, probably. Or the age interval, which is actually, that's age interval that we're looking at from age 0 to age 1, these are the different periods that we want to look at. Survival from 1 year to the next, we can look at survival from the first 5 years to the next 5 years. We define number of females, because really folks, if we're looking at a population, at population dynamics, it's the females. Males do not reproduce. So if you want to look at the population, the dynamics of population, you look at the females. The probability of survival, which relates directly to the number done within this time interval. And then you calculate survivorship, the mean number alive. These are all calculated from the first few. You can add, and you can get to life expectancy. And from all of this, first of all, life expectancy is good for, but it's just how a life table looks. Really, I'm trying to get to the important part for looking at is calculating the population dynamics. Life expectancy is a nice thing to look at, but it's not telling us what we really want to know in ecology. But if if we take the number of young produced at any given stage, and look and calculate from that the net reproductive rate per generation, because we can go back within a life stage how many young are produced. We can also calculate the mean length of regeneration, and from that calculate, I mean, you look at these, all of those are calculations from the table, all information which you collect from following a couple of cohorts over a couple of reproductive periods, and we get the finite rate, the lambda, is r to the power of 1 divided by g, there's the g, there's the r, we can go back and look at these. It's the important factor that we're collecting from that for most ecology or population dynamics is this lambda, the rate of population growth over a given period of time per reproductive. So if we're looking at seasonally reproducing animals over a year, now if we go step back and look at the change in population over a period of time, that's what now we know. At the population at time t plus 1 over 1 unit of time is lambda times the population, size of population, which of course means if it's bigger than 1, positive exponential growth, no population growth, and then negative. And that's an important thing, because what this means, if the population at a certain time is a function of time and the original population, that means that growth will be exponential. It also means that population, if you start dying off, it reduces reproduction, it also drops exponentially. Exponential growth as a term has been another widely misused. People tend to use it as fast growth. Even linear with a steep growth page is a steep growth rate, they call it exponential. Exponential means exactly this type of reproduction. And you can transfer lambda to a continuous function. The change of population over time. And that's an r. What's r? That's how it's e in the power, r is a natural logarithm of lambda. And population as a function of time is, of course, basic. Any comments, questions?
So does this mean that you can only have an exponential growth and have linear growth in some cases?
With all other things being equal, if then population growth will be exponential, because the number of individuals that are alive today are dependent on the number of individuals which were alive before. So growth would have to be exponential. It's just by definition. The actual growth rate can look linear because other factors are falling in. But the basic, the simple, when you just look at reproductive rate, you have an exponential.
I'm just trying to imagine environments where you have resources growing linearly and then the population is growing exponentially.
Resources. Now we come to the issue. What happens when you add resources? When animals cannot reproduce because they're growing in mass and mass run out. If you let animals, elephants, the most slowly reproducing animal on the face of the earth, you'll have elephants, 3 elephant deep within 1,000 years. So this is Raymond Paul, one of the heroes, took that into consideration. And let's see what happens. Let's add the environment let's move from population biology to population ecology, so adding the environment. And let's assume that the environment is working against. The more individuals you have, the less resources you have, the more difficult is it to reproduce. And he came out with a simple one. It got to the logistic model. Added K. K is the maximum number of individuals that an area, that the population can have, because beyond that, the environment cannot maintain. This is called the carrying capacity. If you add that, and this the equation to show the larger the population is, the more difficult it is to reproduce. Your exponential growth becomes, and it, of course, this is supposedly, it looks very, very simple, right? Nice. But as you guys know better than I do, when you start modeling these actual numbers, it doesn't look so nice. Because when you start looking at high reproductive rates, it doesn't curve nicely. It starts overshooting. So if you have the reproductive rate at 0.6, it still looks like nice. If you start at 1.9, it's pretty high, you start having fluctuations. You have dampened oscillations. Okay. That works. But what if we increase even higher? Let's say ours is not 1.9. Let's say that the intrinsic reproductive rate of the species is high. Because we know animals that have a dandelion, right? 1,000 seed. Or even a mouse, 12 pups. We produce every 3 months. Voles, they have a very high reproductive rate. What will happen? This is what happens when you have carrying capacity. You start 2.4 and 3. And at 3, it drops to 0. The question, of course, is the problem, is this the problem with the model? Or does it... They do. It's not... And this is the heart of RNK selection. There's other factors, and you can start adding predation, things like that. But this, the fact that high reproductive rate is not good for reaching any carrying capacity is the heart of the concept of R selection and K selection. Species and sometimes populations that are R selected means they're selected for high R, a high reproductive rate. But these are species which do live in a very, have highest fluctuation, but they reproduce really fast. K selected are animals which reproduce slowly and tend to be around their carrying capacity. These are important, the adaptations, and we go back to the ecology and evolution connection. Where do you live? How do you live? Dandelions. Let's say they reproduce fast. They really reproduce fast. But where do you find dandelions in nature? Not only in your backyard. There are weed disturbed areas. These are areas very quickly, if you cut down a few trees in the middle of the forest, you don't have dandelions there very quickly. A few years later, you won't find a single dandelion. They come in, reproduce, chirp, and then they're out. They can invest in hybrid. They will, it doesn't matter, they won't crash. Because they don't have, they're living. In this time, they want to reproduce a lot, so a few, the chance that a few will survive will happen. This is the concept of R selection. K selection, elephants can have steady populations. They have slow reproductive rates. If they drop below them, they won't overshoot or overshoot slightly. Dandelions will never, but they don't need to because they don't live in environments, they live in short-term ephemeral environments. And these really feed into these two concepts. It's not as simple as that. This feeds into that concept. It's a simple equation, and K is really, you can actually, all it is the maximum number of individuals that this can live there. You just feed that and the reproductive rate, and that's what comes out. More or less, populations, if we're looking at a single individual population, really that's, with no other interactions, that's about where it stands. Another term is metapopulations. It was Levin in 1971 theorized this concept, which took a while for people to actually define. But the idea of a metapopulation are you have small subpopulations. Each cannot survive for very long. See, I step away without giving the, one of the just really complex concepts of natural fluctuations. As K fluctuates, reproductive rate fluctuates, you can have natural, you will have, eventually, random fluctuations in reproductive rate will cause any population eventually to go extinct. It has that combination of chance, by chance, low reproductive. It's not at high reproductive rate. There's, by chance, reproductive failure over too many multiple times. Of course, the chance of failure. The larger the population is, it doesn't matter. Well, the most important thing is the larger the population is, the chance that it will be, that it will go extinct because of these stochastic events is higher. Does that make sense, or am I just, because I jumped to the sideways? The concept of metapopulation population is that each of them on their own can go extinct in a relatively short amount of time. But because of individuals moving between them, they'll be saved. So, this population dies out, small, stochastic, they all died out. Now, if each of them was an oak, die. But no, few individuals came here, repopulated it. This dies out, animals came from there and there, repopulated it. Metapopulation. It is the individual subpopulations are more reproduced and interact with themselves a lot, but there's enough movement between those that will save. For years, people looked for real metapopulations. They couldn't find them. Either they were actually one population, or you had a main and a large population which keeps on invading out to the smaller populations until they start looking at butterflies. This is in Finland, and in many places, butterflies, which are very, that their larvae are limited to some plants, which are patches, you can actually find this sort of dynamic, metapopulation dynamic. It's a concept which comes back, multiple mathematics, but I don't really want to go too much into it because it's another bit I can go into, but it's a side thing of my metapopulation. It's just, this is the basic math, how it relates to how, what is the chance that an individual will go from one population to the next versus the chance that a population, subpopulation will go extinct, and you can figure out 90% some sort of math, which also that the better population will survive if movement between there is higher than the chance of any individual patch going extinct. It's an aside. It's much more complex now, because you probably won't meet many metapopulations in Africa. So far, it's a few. There's most common in butterflies in temperate areas.
Mosheh?
Yes.
Question about metapopulation. Can we consider the zebra problems and metapopulations?
No. A metapopulation, these are subpopulations integrating with each other, and they breed a lot more with each other than moving between. There's much more movement within the patch than between the patches. And these are patches large. This is just a group of individuals within a large population. And I talked about life history at the intersection of individual and population. Now I'm talking about the intersection of community and I think I'm running out of time. Let's see what we can do. We're not yet at communities, we're now at the individual, at one population, one species interacting with another population of another species. And there's a few different types of interaction. You can be negative, which is when I harm you, or my interaction with you is bad for you. And so if you're talking about two, if they're both interacting with each other negatively, that usually defines competition. It's rare that you have predation. If you both are good for each other, that's called mutualism. We know all about that because we have flowers and bees, we have E. coli and us. This is when two individuals help each other out. Two species, two populations. You can also have positive and neutral and negative and neutral. So negative and neutral commensalism is a classic, well, a tree and an annual underneath it. That tree is shading out that annual. It's really doing bad. The annual is not affecting the tree. Really not affecting, not any. And sometimes it's even, that's really small. Sometimes it's, when a bison is smashing plants as it goes around, it's not good for the plant. It has no effect on the bison whatsoever. Positive and nothing is also a bird living, putting its nest in a tree, up in a branch of a tree. It's doing well for itself. It's gaining some protection from the tree. The tree is not gaining or losing anything. If there's a bird up there, there's not a bird up there, it couldn't care less. And finally, negative and positive, some people's favorite, that's all when one takes advantage and one suffers. Predation, that's exploitation, so it's herbivory, predation, parasitoidism, and parasitism. Parasitoidism and parasitism. I won't have time. So basically, let's go really quickly through competition. We'll go through because these are very different, not very, but somewhat different things. Competition. Both individuals need this resource. Both are utilizing it, and by utilizing it, it's denying it to the other individual. There's always competition between members of the same species. This looking at competition. The presence of one reduces resources to the other. Exploitative. If you kill your prey, it's predation. That's what parasitism is. Of course, it's not a real one, but I love it. It's, remember, species? Ichneumon wasp. They lay their eggs inside beetles. When it emerges, it kills that egg. Once you have that egg, that caterpillar is not going to survive. And that's parasites, their host survives. Ticks, diseases, you survive. Whatever survives. Parasitism, the host does not survive. The difference between that and predation is very specialism, very specialist. You can usually multiple predators on one prey, and it's usually long period. Herbivory and parasitism do not kill. Most herbivory, actually all herbivory, because if it kills a plant, it's actually considered predation, seed predation. It's not really herbivory. Symbiosis, usually used only for the positive, but symbiosis really means long-term evolutionary interaction between two species. And it can be parasitoids, parasites, and mutualism. Mutualism is usually part of a symbiosis, parasitism, parasitism, yeah, that too. Like human head lice, they don't work in anybody else. Long-term evolution. We've tried to evolve away from them, not so successfully. Term of coevolution. So the math, there's in predation, and there's also a lot, there's math, different. That's where the different logical Volterra, somebody raised logical Volterra, that's in both competition and predation. But I don't know if I'll get to that today. I'm trying to get the terminology. Coevolution is when two species have a long-term evolutionary history. They have a long history together. And if they're mutualists, they try and evolve to be specialized. If they are antagonistic, one tries to evolve away and the other responds. And it was first looked on butterfly on caterpillars. The plants evolve all of these chemicals which are poisonous. The caterpillars evolve ways to break down the poison. And they both tend to be evolutionary because they have evolutionary pressure. They also go back to ecology because they are each other's environment. As I said, evolution, ecology, are intersected. That I'm not going into math. I did it very quickly on population, but we don't have time. This is terms, so you know what competition means, so you know what coevolution means, so you know what symbiosis, these terms. When we go beyond these two interacting species, we're talking about community. Multiple, how multiple species interact with each other, these are communities. I think the problem is, before I can get into communities, it's 5.
I think it's scheduled for 5:30.
Okay.
If you have more.
Oh, yeah. I just got communities. Communities as a unit, this is, again, a very complex... Populations, at least we know, they're all one species. We know predator and prey. Communities become even worse. Because what a community is it a unit or is it not a unit, is a basic long-term debate in ecology. All starting the beginning of, see, the last century, I was teaching this before 2000, so that's why. It's the beginning of the 20th century. Two, their communities are basically a higher level of organization. Species in a community tend to go together. That's Clements and Shelford and my academic lineage, and I actually did my PhD in the Shelford building in Urbana. So I have a son, even though they were quite often wrong. This was the way that communities were thought, because it worked on plant, especially Clements worked on plant communities, and it looked like when you in these woods and temperate areas, which always hung together, the higher level of organization. Victor Shelford expanded at Tamworth. Now, in 1926, a biochemist looked at it and said, no. They happen to be together because they match, because they are coexisting, because they are with, this is their tolerance. This is where you have oak and maple. It's not because oak and maple like being together. It's because this is within the range of tolerance of oak and the range of tolerance of maple. If you move out of where an oak can survive, you will find maple with something else. Well, as all of these debates, of course, this one, he was trashed, at least because he wasn't an ecologist, saying something which didn't agree with what people, with this wonderful pattern that people thought they saw. Eventually had to leave ecology and went back to biochemistry. Unfortunately for the ecologists, he was mostly right. Mostly they're together because we have species together, because they are within the same level of tolerance. Sometimes you have groups which tend to go together, and sometimes they even interact. But if one of those species cannot survive there because it's too hot, it's too wet, it won't be there. But the other ones will be. The terms that Clements developed, succession, are true. You see a change in population, but that's because the individual species really matter. There is some Clementsian thought floating over. In some cases, it looks like it's correct, and actually does follow his ideas of a higher level of organization, but by and large, the community is just what you have there. And communities rarely have borders. The borders of a community are what you draw, usually. Sometimes you can see it. A pond community, you can look at that entire pond. But if you're looking at eastern deciduous forest, you cannot look at the entire unit because it covers all of the Midwest, or northern Midwest, the entire area of Wisconsin and parts of Michigan. Where does it end? Wherever you put it. It's a useful concept to work with. It's not always a very real, it's a concept just that they are interacting with each other, and these are the species that are there, and these are the ones that are interacting with each other, but the community is not a unit, is not a real unit in that sense. They are interacting with each other. And if there was, there wasn't, if there was white organs and black organs, it would be a different community. But this is not a unit in the way of populations. It's a level of organization at which you can study it. It's not a level of organization which is a unit, a higher level of organization as a unit. Does it make sense? So people use talk about communities. And if you look on in Pala, you have the community of herbivores. So you have the zebras, you have the impalas, you have the kudu, you have the giraffes. But they won't always be together. This is the community. This is where they have these other people they're interacting with. But if you go 3,000 kilometers or 100 kilometers to El Pajeta, you guys been there, you'll see, quite often see another community, a different community. Because zebras don't need kudu to survive or to be. They don't follow each other. And that's why, as the communities are continuing, oak maple will move to oak hickory as conditions change. Hard to put a line, because you find 300 more. They move on continuum, you have a species distribution, and whatever the community is, those species which happen to be together. The terminology of communities, and this is important, and what people tend to look at in communities, are species diversity, composition, and community structure. What species are, species diversity, there are different ways, and structure, community structure, is how the interactions work. There are different ways to estimate diversity. The simplest way is species richness. How many species are within that area? Within the borders of the power of Pala power, how many species? Count the number of species. It is simplest, but it's not always that good. Because you have 35 species of birds, but two of them just landed and flew away, or are almost extinct. You won't find them more. Versus another one has all those 35 and all have breeding populations. Species richness is the same, but they have different diversity. So diversity indices are simply, the only important thing that you have to know is that the more there are of each species, the higher diversity. So it's not only how many species, but how many there are in each species. And the more even it is, the more diverse. So if there's a lot of mini species, is more diverse than a lot of one species and very small number of other species. The Simpsons, and that's why, really, all function of proportion of each species, and the higher the proportion of each species, or the more even the proportions are, the higher the diversity is. Number and proportions. Species composition also looks at dominant species, and indicator species. The dominant are the most abundant species, the indicator species. If you see the species, you know what you have. You know what community you have. It's not always the most dominant. And that's why I'm oak hickory, because the indicator species are oak and hickory. You could maybe have a lot of annuals underneath, even more than you have one individual because they're smaller. But oak hickory, because when you see the oaks and you see the hickories, you know what else you're finding, the underbrush and what mammals you're finding, etc., etc., etc. And the community structure are the interactions. Most commonly described are feeding, who eats who, or how the energy flows between the different individual, different species. But you can also look at competition, interference, facilitation, other interactions, and you create. So you create different types of webs. So connectedness, usually, who eats who. Energy flow, it's not only who eats who, but how much. So you might have lions eating zebras, kudu, and giraffe, but they're really most, and elephants, ever so often an elephant, but they're mostly eating zebra And so you have a lot of energy between zebras and lions, much few less energy between animals, which they eat less. Then you have functional web, which basically how that doesn't look, we don't care how. How does the presence of this species affect other species? It might affect it because of competition. It might because of parasitism. It might because of predation. It might because of mutualism. It's just looking at who's interacting and how strong is it. And it's simply, the way that you look at that is actually quite often simple correlation. When you have different population sizes of X, what are the population sizes of Y? And you use the coefficient, usually the B, to indicate. But that's just ways. It's how strongly one affects the other. Any questions until now? I've been talking. Any questions? Trying to look. You were there when I 2 years ago, weren't you? When I was talking to the other group, I know that you went to the other group. Were you the one when I talked?
I was.
Has anything changed? Or are you not?
I'm just interested in.
I think you had more slides.
I think I got further. I'm getting further now.
Yeah, I remember the insurance thing and the presentation.
Finally, we'll get to ecosystems. Ecosystems, yeah.
Wait, so I have a question about when you were talking about relationships between populations. When you have like a negative-negative interaction or a negative-neutral interaction, that can't be adaptive, right?
Of course. Competition is very adaptive.
Well, no, one has to benefit in some way from...
If negative-negative, neither of them likes being.
So what's an example of a negative-negative? Maybe I don't understand.
Of negative-negative? Two grazers. I mean, actually, there are two species of zebra.
Mm-hmm. So they're both competing for the same.
For the same graph, yeah. Not actually the niche. I didn't go deeply into competition because if two species fill the same niche, how can they coexist? Because one has to be better than the other. You can't have two ones that are exactly equal. And the one who's better at least at one thing will drive whatever resource too low for the other to use it. And the other one goes extinct. But there's different ways. They're shown that you can still coexist, but basically, two species that need the same, the predators on the Serengeti strongly competing. In fact, they take that competition to actually fighting. That's why lions kill the cubs of any other predator. But that's nothing compared to the fact that they're eating the prey that the other one can eat.
Between two predators, we have a negative.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Sometimes you have negative positive because golden eagles eat foxes. Foxes are predator, but they're now prey too. So that's why it's not, the old idea of food pyramid is not very useful. That's why you tend to the food webs. Because some predators are also prey, some. And then you have the weird things that butterflies pollinate. So butterfly adults are mutual with flowers. But there are larvae are herbivores on the leaves of other plants. Life stages, life again, this goes back to life stages, to life history and life cycle. But the life cycle, complex life cycles create a whole different ecological pattern than simple life cycles. Anybody else? More questions. Next term is so now we've gone. All that community are not living in a vacuum. There's soil, there's wind, there is abiotic surroundings. And those, when you start feeding those in, then you get the ecosystem. A by the physical environment. So a community, you have in general, the autotrophs, these are the individuals, these are the species and populations which create biomass. They use an outside sort of energy, usually the sun, not always, and they create biomass, and basically they fix that energy into chemical form, biochemical form. Then you have all the individuals which basically live off of that material, secondary target. So herbivores, predators eat the herbivores. Most important are the species which break down, live on the trash. The tritivores, who basically take all of that organic material, use the energy, use what they can, end up excreting everything else. Basically, they send it back to its inorganic components: carbon dioxide, nitrogen as nitric acid, as urea. Also, all of those nutrients back into their mineral form. And with when you look at ecosystems, you start looking at those things, at these materials, how they flow in the entire ecosystem, how materials and energy move through the community and the area surrounding the community. And this is what you look in the ecosystem. Energy is a flow. Energy comes from the sun, or in rare cases from the earth. It goes into the system and it's out. Eventually, all the energy of the sun is lost into space. The sun stops shining, that's it. Dead. The entire ecosystem, all ecosystems fall, except for the deep ocean ones. On the vents, most ecosystems collapse. On the other hand, you have nutrients and material, and it's water and then nutrients cycle. The amount of carbon inside in the world, amount of water in the world is changing, is almost not changing at all. It's cycling, it's going from one component of the ecosystem to the other. Carbon goes from the atmosphere to plants, to herbivores, to detritivores, and back into the atmosphere. And back again.
So, are you saying that an ecosystem is what system? Is that flow of energy that goes in, also has to go out, has to maintain a certain balance?
Theoretically, a closed ecosystem is a conservative. Because ecosystems are rarely closed, you sometimes are losing into another ecosystem. The Earth, the combined ecosystems of the Earth, are a closed system. And sometimes, at the level of system, and sometimes even at the level of biomes, because there are some materials which never move from one hemisphere to the next, or from one. Sometimes an island can be within its own ecosystem, almost nothing leaves, almost. But it's extremely rare. An ecosystem, the world is a conservative. But you have sometimes a loss of there, because carbon dioxide moves across the entire world. Mm-hmm. Most anything which becomes gas is spread, or in the water. So
we're still calling them ecosystems.
Again,
we're still calling them ecosystems.
Yes.
Even in the conservative. There's no requirement.
Where does an ecosystem end? It's like a community. Whatever you decide. Sometimes there's easy borders, like again a pond, but a pond is a lot of organic material being dumped in from the outside. And sometimes you're talking about forest ecosystem, wherever you, just as long as it's large enough that you have enough individuals that you can start looking at large scale processes. So the trophic levels, when we talk about trophic, and those are, in talking about feeding, energy movement, autotrophs, usually plants, some bacteria, usually you find one level. This is the old pyramid, so you just understand. Then the primary consumers, those are any individual which eats plants. Predators are any individual which eats another animal. The detritivore is any individual which eats dead material. Most species do it all. For example, I'll go back to my mice, because they were my PhD thing. Mice, what do you think mice eat when you think of mice?
Worms.
What?
Worms.
Mice.
Worms. Worms.
A mouse eats worms.
No.
What we think of it, well, I'm not saying it doesn't, but what?
Everything.
But where, why do you find mice usually in the house? Where do you
grains?
Grains. They're grammables, but they actually eat everything. So my mice eat a lot of acorns in the summer. Over the winter, they're eating 40-50% animal insects. Shrews will mostly eat other animals. Voles, you know, but most animals, you feel the weirdest things eat. So a squirrel eats nuts, right? Except when it finds a bird's egg, and then it will eat the eggs. Some large mice would eat smaller mice. They should, but very few animals are very specific. Aphids are very specific. They phloem from the, suck up from the plant. That's really the only thing they eat. Most species, though, exist on multiple, which is why it's really less than a pyramid. It's a food web, a trophic web. Trophic food movement of organic material, but mostly energy. That's really how it works in trophic levels. Generalized. That's why that old pyramid, which I don't especially like, but if we're talking about energy from the sun, photosynthesis, dead material to detritivores, all of this is through respiration. Energy is lost through respiration. Really. With the carbon dioxide, it's going up. Almost most of the energy in the ecosystem goes through detritivores. Not through predators, not. Mostly it's broken down. We're talking about biomass in a terrestrial system. Most of it goes through the detritivores. Most things die and rot, basically. It's especially true in forests, where, because trees, very few herbivores can eat that wood, and only really fungi can break it down. Classical nutrient cycle, nitrogen. Nitrogen, on one hand, is the most common gas, 80% of our atmosphere about. It is critical to all living things because it's a critical component of proteins. It's not a simple thing because most plants even can't use nitrogen in its atmosphere and do. It has to go through a whole thing. Only some bacteria can break it down. So it's very complex. Nitrogen is not coming into the world. Nitrogen is not leaving the world, but it's being circulated. It's nitrified as bacteria. It's assimilated into plants. You put it into proteins. Proteins are then taken, used, finally broken down, and set free as usually as ammonia. Doesn't matter, but basically this is a concept of nutrients. You look at carbon, it will look like this. Look at sulfur, at calcium, at phosphate. These are all critical parts of all living things, because your proteins, besides having nitrogen and carbon, your proteins will have sulfur, they will have phosphate is important because you have DNA and RNA, etc. But this is how it looks. This thing is because massive burning of fossil fuels is mixing things up in a very interesting way. It's not the only thing which, I mean, that's nothing compared to those huge, few hundred million years ago, there was a huge explosion of a lot of methane gas. It set free, created under there, boom, dropped oxygen levels in the earth from something like close to 30% down to 60%. Now it's 20%. Compared to that, industrial revolution is small change. Knocked out some 95% of all living species. Might have been a meteor impact on top of that. Lots of them. Let's step aside again. Because ecosystems, there are different types of ecosystems. So you can have a forest ecosystem, a prairie ecosystem, agricultural ecosystem, urban. Sometimes when you look at multiple types of ecosystem within the same area, you look at a landscape. And this is a fairly new concept of looking at ecology at the level of the landscape. And landscape ecology has become the new. And here we should know a lot more about, because visualization for landscape ecology, that they are one of the major uses of GIS and different types of visualization. It's how different types of ecosystems interact with each other across, and how does it look when you look at an entire landscape? And then it goes to open systems, because ecosystem, the forest, what's going on, what's moving between the forest and the prairie, what's moving between those and the agriculture and the urban ecosystems. Landscapes, multiple ecosystem types, and how they interact with one another. Very large scale ecology. And then you start looking at really interesting things, because animals, for example, can move through multiple. And you can look at their movement or spread. Then you start looking at population superimposed on landscape. You have really weird things. The ecosystem scale and how size work becomes really fascinating, because you look at a cow and it's an individual, you look at its rumen, and you have a community. Fun and games, but the terms are just exactly so. Landscape, looking at multiple patches of multiple types of ecosystem in a. Then you have terms, and then you look at habitat. And sometimes when it's small, rather than looking at calling it an ecosystem, it's called a habitat, especially when we're looking at only a small number of species within a certain ecosystem. So if we're going back to the forest community, right, but you're looking at a forest species, for that forest species, it's a patch of habitat, because that's where it lives, and the multiple. So if we're looking from the point of view of a species, the ecosystem is habitat. And if we're looking at the process, how a species interacts with all of that ecosystem, they're looking at, and we're talking about habitat. From our point of view, it's an ecosystem, but if we're looking at how that animal is living, moving between them, they're habitat patches.
So if we're studying the UIC greenhouse with rabbits, it's called habitat?
Yeah. It's a habitat. For rabbits inside the city, their habitat patch of the lawns. Go back to my mice, the downstate Illinois is full of these forest patches. That's what its habitat patches are. It's always about scale, about how you look at things. Most important is that you know these terms and what ecologists are looking at, what sort of things they're looking at. And the terminology. I don't think I'll go into this. Do we have any time at all?
1 minute.
Because it's not, this just talks about how biomes are distributed, how the ecology of the world of biomes. I don't think you'll be dealing with that much. It just explains things that you should know, why it's hotter in the tropics and wetter in the tropics. But this is, okay. Questions?
In the model of population growth, the saturation comes as a consequence of the interaction with other species and the environment. Like, for example, if you are herbivore,
yeah.
Your saturation is given by your relationship with the grass.
Yes. And if you're grass, then it's by nitrogen or phosphate in the soil, and sometimes by space. And it also, it's the first term, it relates to a term called density dependence. And so the higher, how processes change, the more dense or less dense a species is, and reproduction is a classical. The more individuals are at lower, you have more than you produce faster because you can find a mate quicker. But once you start driving your resources on, that is another term which I sort of spoken, which is resources. Resources is basically for any organism what it needs in order to survive and reproduce. It's a general term. It might be space, it might be oxygen, it might be prey, it might be nesting sites for bird. They're all resources. The final thing which is important, which I'll talk about because I did, is niche, or
as Americans pronounce it, niche. I do not like that pronunciation. I like niche. But I guess niche is just as acceptable. It's a theoretical multi-dimensional space in which every organism lives. And the dimensions are its resources. Okay? I'm still, because I'm not a mathematician, have difficulty visualizing anything more than three dimensions, but that's what it is. And it can be space, temperature. The biggest problem is defining, we know what a niche is of an existing animal, more or less, but how many niches there are in a community, is something missing? Can a new species invade without driving others to extinction? You never know. You only know what a niche is when there's an animal or plant or organism inhabiting that niche. Sometimes you discover that there's a, like horses went extinct in North America. The moment some feral horses went out, they came back. They're doing really well, but they're feral. But there's those of following these, they're not wild horses, they're feral. They've been feral for 300 years, but horses evolved. I mean, they might have evolved in North America, but there are many species of wild horses when the first humans came over. And I think the humans, or it might have been something before, but the fact is, it seems to have been an empty niche because they spread without actually driving anything else to extinction. Of course, we don't know what the mess was, why when humans came over, they knocked out most of the large mammals and birds that lived here before humans came, about 10,000 years, 12,000 years ago. But that's niche. Tangent, sorry. Other questions?
Something, my question is regarding the example of the octopus at the beginning when you said that you can reproduce only one time. So is that only the female or the male as well?
The male will, however many females I don't know how many it can fertilize, but it will fertilize one season and then die.
So he creates the material to fertilize only once, and that's it, right?
It reproduces once.
So then he will die after the...
The
process will make him die?
Wait, you mean that... I think what you're saying is it's only one reproductive cycle.
Reproduces, if over time... I don't think so. I actually have to look that up. I know that the female, keeping its eggs until they hatch, kills it. Males might reproduce and just die, because that's it. It's a clock. It's basically, you reproduce, that's it, you've done. And here's an interesting thing to think about mathematically. What is the advantage of having multiple episodes of reproduction? That means that when you reproduce, you just have one, it's as though you had one more kid. That's all. So if you survive and you had 100, it's like you had two more kids. Having two more kids is exactly the same as surviving. The question is, what becomes the advantage? I mean, there are ways, but it's a really reproductive success. It doesn't increase your reproductive success by all that much, especially if you are like an oak, right? So just something to think of. What are the advantages of being reproducing once versus multiple times? And you have things like bees. The females can live multiple, reproduce multiple times. Males reproduce once.
Or the salmon reproduce once.
Western sockeyes are not Atlantic salmon reproduce multiple times. But they love trawling the sockeye because it has this very, very, going back up, but the Atlantic salmon reproduces multiple times. But again, closely related species, different life history.
So what is the advantage of dying here? Why would the salmon die? It's the same species that the one that dies earlier.
Oh, closely related species. I don't know.
Well, it doesn't consume resources that would be used by its young.
it might be increasing because these are fairly stale, these ponds, and it's adding that. It's also the energy that it blows to do that. It would have to go burn out that much energy to come back, and overall, it would do better. Again, because surviving just is like having two more young, while the cost of surviving is much higher. Cost, again, trade-off. What is the reproductive advantage? What's the price? What are you gaining? What are you losing doing this versus this? You can only do one.
Just a curiosity, I recently read a non-scientific article about lobsters who don't age. Have you heard about that? So their death is only determined by the fact that they grow bigger, and so predators see them and kill them because they want to eat them. But lobsters naturally don't age. They can live potentially forever, but they don't live forever because the probability of getting eaten by predators increases, by humans as well.
I'm not only sure about, there might also be disease, because you don't, I think one of the reasons that human senescence, it's called, is because otherwise that disease and disease and predation isn't enough.
It's just curiosity, because they're immortal if they don't get it.
What's the longest time that anyone's kept a lobster alive? That's the question.
I think more than 100 years. I also read that.
Yeah, they've captured lobsters who have been around, like, estimated age of 100 years.
That actually is interesting, and evidently they can survive disease pretty well as well.
But the gene they recognize as doing that is really, not the genes themselves.
They can
pour over the same biological technique to humans to make them immortal because we would die by that process.
I would offhand, because no one's exactly sure how we age. I mean, they're learning. It might be a characteristic of the chromosome, at the level of the chromosomes, rather than a gene.
Yeah. Okay.
So if you have a different structure of chromosomes.
I think it was a hormone which was called telecose something, and actually their level of reproduction increases over the age. So the older they are, the more they can reproduce.
And they don't have a drop. That's actually really interesting. Do you have the send it? Because
actually,
I
it's on Wikipedia. It's written there. I checked. It's not really scholarly article, but.
Thing is, some animals have been just recently. Tortoise died, and it was, I don't know, 200 years old. They know how old it was because one of the older naturalists, like Humboldt, brought it back with them, and it was living in the zoo. And it was records lived for like 200 years. Reptiles can live a long time. Some fish, we don't know how long some fish can live, but we know that octopus, even the biggest one, don't live.
So it would be interesting how model changes when parents can live very long, so they will have to compete with their children in the end, and maybe it's better for them to not to have
trees. I mean, yeah, the Joshua tree is the Joshua tree, and that was just 4,000 years old. So I think it has to do with what is the chance of any of your offspring reaching maturity? And when that drops, almost no acorn survives to the next to reproduce. So you really have surviving, having those two extra advantage is worthwhile, because there's a very high chance that within a given year you'd have zero reproductive success. With lobsters, it's interesting, because what is the chance of surviving of an individual, even though you're not aging? What is your chance of being eaten? Because your survival rate doesn't only have senescence. Mice live only 3 years, but voles in captivity will live 3 years and then they die, but they never live to 3 years. On average, they die after 3 months. They're dead of somebody's food. So I don't know why lobsters don't have that as well. I don't know. And sharks don't get cancer. Other animals do. So it's genetics. Is it an advantage? But not everything. That is a fallacy. Every characteristic that is in a living organism has some evolutionary benefit. It's not. We have a lot of disadvantages. Standing up was a really good idea for many reasons. However, backaches, sinus infections, hernias, high level, and all of these, large brain, great idea, high mortality and birth. We have the highest of all, naturally have the highest of all, one of the highest in all, definitely the highest of all primates. How do you get that thing out? And we still have the babies born 9 months underdeveloped compared to monkeys. We're the only simian that the baby's born without its head closed.